We are at a place of prophecy fulfilled in our community. We're not at a place of prophecy fulfilled in my life or prophecy fulfilled in your ministry. We're at a place in prophecy fulfilled for what God said He wanted to do in this community. It is not because we've strategized so carefully. It is not because we have a good program. It's not because we really set our sights and came up with a great way to accomplish the goal. It is simply because we did what God to us, and He is making the way. If you don't understand what I'm talking about, in 2000, I was searching for a place to start a church. I had ministered for years in a church that I grew up in. Grew up playing around the building when my dad and the pastor at that time built the building with several other men, and in the 70s. And I was at that church, and I had been there for a number of years. I had done two stints there since I was 19 years old in ministry. And God had given me and the pastor there in 1998, I think, a vision. The vision was to start an outreach ministry downtown in an old storefront that would reach people that normally don't go to church, that would reach them where they're at. At the time, I was going to a church where it was a churchy church, and you walked in, you didn't dress right, you looked funny, and people stared at you, and a lot of people wouldn't go into a place like that. And we had all these ideas of what this ministry was going to be like, and that pastor had unfortunately succumbed to the enemy. For lack of better words, he screwed up, and the church was trying to restore him, and instead of being humbled by that restoration, he became arrogant and fought against what God was doing, and he was removed from the church, and actually the denomination sent him out of state to a program, and he's now pastoring a church, and God's doing awesome things in his life, but it was just that place of kicking against the goads kind of thing. And in comes, after that, they brought in an old pastor. He was 65 years old when he got there.
Really old?
And he was really old. No. There wasn't anybody. You guys sat underneath him for a while, Phil and Laura, right? And he was old. I mean, it wasn't just that the date was old. He was old school. Old school. I remember when he came there and we had the fish house out behind the building, and he said to me, "I don't understand the purpose of this. Why are you ministering to these teenagers like this? Why can't you just have Bible study?" And it was like, whoa. And, you know, we had this long conversation. It was just a nonstop battle, and I stayed there for a couple of years. And I shared with him this vision that we had about this ministry and the community and all of that. And he was excited about it, but he couldn't pull the trigger. There were people in the church who just wouldn't do it. They just couldn't see the sense in spending the money and the time and the energy. And so I remember there was some turmoil and there was things going on, and God was just telling me, "Mike, you know, you need to do what I told you to do." But I'm like, "But he's my pastor, and I'm in this church, and blah, blah, blah." I'll never forget praying one day, and I was at church, and it was Sunday afternoon, and we're getting ready for Sunday service. And in walks a man that my father mentored in the ministry. And he's elderly, he's passed away since. And he walks into my office, he goes, "Mike, I gotta tell you something." He goes, "God told me to come in here and talk to you." I was like, "Okay, well, this guy's never talked to me. He'd just say, 'Hi, Mike.'" You know, Jesse's orange. And he walks into my office, he goes, "God just told me to tell you this. I don't know why, but sometimes, Mike, it's okay to go." I'm like, "Really?" He goes, I don't know what that means. And he goes, I think I know what it means, but that's what God told me to tell you. Sometimes it's okay to go. And so I left the church there, and I actually had my stuff out of the office by the end of the day. When you're praying for God to tell you something, and God sends somebody who's a godly man, walks in and just says what God, the answer, you sort of know what the answer is, right? And so if God tells you to jump in a pool of sharks, you jump in a pool of sharks. You don't try to figure out how you're going to survive. Right, Mike? Right. Okay. And so that's what I did. I just, it's time to go. And I left. And I didn't want to start this ministry from leaving there. I was the worship leader, the youth pastor. I was a pivotal person in ministry there. And if I started this church from leaving there, I was afraid people were going to come with me and hurt that church. So I went to Columbus for about a year and a half to 2 years and sort of went down there with some friends that I used to minister with and to a bigger church and ministered there on and off, helped out with different things. And I came here to plant this church. And I remember when we planted the church, there were some people that prayed. There were prayer warriors. What was her, Beth's mom? What was her name? Crazy lady? Beth's mom, remember? Was her name Diane? Yeah. And she's a wild, crazy. Yeah, you were friends with Beth at the time, right? Yeah. And she's a wild, crazy, but she loved the Lord at that time. I don't even know what she's doing. But she would walk the streets of downtown praying that God would do what he's done. I don't know if you guys understand this. She'd walk the streets of downtown praying that God would do what he has done. Do you understand this? I mean, it's like, I tell my wife, I'm like, are we really doing this? Is this really happening? Are we really sitting in this building? Are we really doing these ministries? And because 16 years of praying and working and diligently being faithful to God when it looked like it was a waste of time. She would pray that God was going to change the community and that he would put something here that would change the community. Folks, we started doing a soup kitchen luncheon once a month. The only people in the community that were doing a luncheon was the Salvation Army. And the only reason they were doing it was because they were getting paid by the government to do it. Okay? Today, you can get a meal for free in Marion every day of the week. And it's churches. And she would pray for God to do things like homeless shelters and discipleship centers and youth ministries and a place where people would know they could go. And God has. He's done it. He's called many of you here to join. Not join the church, not join Pastor Mike in his quest. No, join him in what he is doing. This has nothing to do with me, folks. There were people praying for this for years. I think back about her carrying her banners around, praying, marching the streets and the alleys in downtown Marion. Prayer works. If God can find people who will respond and commit themselves to God's plan instead of their plan, not be the person standing over trying to judge whether God's doing it right or not. I want you to think about this, folks. How many of you guys have ever been at our council meetings? Raise your hand. Do you guys really think that this is an organized group of people? Folks, it's absolutely ridiculous. And you're like, well, Pastor Mike, why aren't you more organized? Because that's not how God works. Any other questions? Well, Pastor Mike, why don't you structure things more? Because that's not how God works. Read your Bible. Have you ever read your Bible? Anybody know what happens when men gets together and starts planning and scheduling and organizing everything? Anybody know what happens?
God intentionally uses it.
That's right. So we can't do that. That's not how God works. Well, so-and-so built this church of 20,000 people. I don't want a big church. I want a powerful church for the kingdom of God. So I don't care about big churches. Okay? I really don't. I want a powerful church that can be used of God, filled with disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what I want. People who are being challenged to grow in their walk with the Lord. I'm the never-ending coach. We could go out and win the game 100-0 in football, and the next morning on Saturday morning, I'm going to show up and show you the things you did wrong. I'm not going to be mad. I'm just going to show you the things we did wrong or things we could have done better. That's just who I am. Why? Because I want my team to grow. I want you to mature. Oh, we could celebrate Friday night. Woohoo! Way to go, way to go. Have chicken sandwiches in the gym afterwards, whatever. We can do that. But Saturday morning, we're going to get back to work and we're going to get busy. Why? Because this isn't about my experience in ministry. This is about advancing the kingdom of God. This isn't about yours and my feelings about how we're doing. This is about obeying God. Think about that. Think about it. Do you guys realize the church is moving into a building that everything God prophesied can happen? And we already have almost all of those programs rooted and started. Do you realize that? There are no more excuses. Last night, they had an increase in attendance at the youth program. The excitement wasn't, oh, they're finally coming back. The excitement was, oh, God's doing it. Now, I'm not excited that God's going to do it, because I knew God was going to do it. I'm excited that the group of people that I was ministering with got it. That they had been faithful through the good and the lean. That they understood to be faithful and that God would do it in His timing, in His way. To me, that's exciting. Where were you when you were, Dan, where were you when you were in your 20s? What kind of mighty man of God would you have been if you were experiencing the power of God in your life and in your ministry on a normal basis in your 20s? Where would you be today? How many of you have the advantage of walking with people all of your life in your childhood, seeing God use them to advance His kingdom? All of your life, and you just expect God to do supernatural, mighty things. How many have that opportunity? Just a few of us. Well, folks, we have a relatively good amount of 20-somethings and early 30-somethings that since they were teenagers, they have been watching God do His work. You're like, well, that's good. That's exciting. No, you don't understand. You understand? These people have faith. They have understanding of how God moves and how to faithfully do His work and be faithful to His call. These people, folks, 40 years from now, you're going to be able to plop them down anywhere and watch God move. 20 years from now, you're going to be able to plop them down anywhere and watch God move. 10 years from now, 5, how about now? Most of you didn't have that opportunity. Most of you, you're watching for the first time. I'm so excited, I can't see straight. Seriously, this isn't out of excitement of moving over there. Trust me, folks. After we got the building, about 2 weeks into it, the excitement wore off. Maybe the first weekend, the excitement wore off. Okay? And we keep finding more and more things that need to be fixed with that place. That's completely irrelevant. It's just completely irrelevant. I can't tell you how many people in this community are so excited for our church, not because God's will is being done. They're excited. Listen to this. Because there's a group of people willing to do whatever they think is right to do, and it doesn't have to be done right. And they see the fruit in it. I had a local professional business owner here in the community. He saw me at Dollar General picking up, what was I picking up? I was picking up wasp spray for Chris because he was being attacked by wasp on a ladder. It's a bad place to be. Got stung like 3 or 4 times in the head, you know. And he sees me come in, and I was on the phone, and he was at the register. And he gets done, and he hunts me down. And he says, I saw you out there working on the sidewalks. And he was excited because we were just doing what we had to do to use the building. Some of you talk to people in the community, and they look down at this organization because we don't hire somebody to come out and fix the sidewalks, and we don't get an architect to decide how we're going to move a toilet, and we don't do all kinds of stuff like this, right? And we don't do it the right way. How do I say this? They're not laughing anymore. They're not laughing. They're like, We know this to be true because we spent a lot of hours with a local official this week walking through our building. He spent a lot of hours the next day after our first meeting on the phone with people in the community about our building and what we were doing. See, if it was any other way, who would get the glory? The church? Us? We'd be known as the Butter Church. I'm serious. I'll never forget somebody asked a pastor here in the community, they're going through this $15 million building project, and they said, I want my grandchildren to come to Marion, Ohio and see what their dad built. Their granddad did. What God used him to do in this community. I don't. If you all forget me when I'm dead, your children and your grandchildren forget me, that's okay. It's okay if they forget me. As long as they remember the passion that we have for Jesus Christ. They can forget everything I've ever done. My favorite Bible teacher, you know, I thought it might have been somebody else, and then I found out they're a little bit crazy over here on the tribulation. So my favorite Bible teacher now is still Chuck Swindoll. Chuck says we always need to check our motives, nonstop. Check our motives. Why are we doing this? Are we doing it because we want to accomplish a goal, or are we doing it because God told us to? And we want to remain in right relationship with Jesus Christ. Many of you do not know how fine the thread and the needle was that God wove to get us in a place where we can use that building across the street. You should have walked through that inspection with us. How fine the needle was. We don't even understand that the fact that the state showed up about the thrift store, God used. What do you mean? Well, the fire marshal here in town called the plans examiner that I spoke with and said, hey, I got this organization, the plans examiner said, yeah, I spoke with Mike Green a couple weeks ago. And yeah, and they decided they were going to put the store in. And yeah, and everything's fine. And yeah, if they ever, everything was fine. If that hadn't happened, there would have been a little bit more scrutiny. We don't even understand how powerful the hand of God is, working behind the scenes to accomplish His goal. We have nothing to do with it. I didn't plan on that guy showing up. I didn't plan on calling it. I just show up, say, God, what do you have us doing today? That's it. God is amazing. My sermon today is to get you to live your life the same way. That's my whole point. My whole purpose in life is to motivate people to live their lives for Jesus Christ. I can't think of a better testimony than the fact that this is our last service in this building. You want to know how creepy it is? We came to this building in 2005 expecting God to move in a mighty way. We had some people in the church and leadership that had the wrong motives. They split the church. We actually had someone. God sent a prophet. Sorry, she was a woman. A prophetess. God sent a prophet to us to prophesy to us what was going to happen to the church. She said, when you move over there, there's going to be a great earthquake in your church, and over half the church is going to collapse, and there will just be a small group of you huddled together, willing to do what God told you to do. She had a dream. She came to church. Her name was Marilyn. She had a dream. She came to the church here just to tell us this. She was here 1 week, and she had a dream. She came back the next week to share this vision that God gave her. We were getting ready to move over here. And we had people in the council say, well, then we need to stop moving over there. It's like, too late. We've made promises. We've made commitments. Well, what are we going to do? What God told us to do. Well, what if that happens? What are we going to do? What God told us to do. It happened. Back in 2005, the average monthly giving was over $10,000 a month in this organization. We had over 100 people attend church on a normal basis. Church split, we went down to about 35 people and about $3,000 a month. Somehow we made it out of that. We huddled together in a little building over there, and God started growing the church. God's amazing, folks. What's so sick and twisted about this is God brought us right back here to complete His promise. What do you mean? Oh, Dan, remember the council meeting when we figured out the mall didn't want us there because they kept shutting off the air conditioning? The air conditioning would just go off in the middle of service, right before service started. It would come on right when we were done. The mall director was there at the time. We were like, where do we go? What do we do? And we kicked stones and looked, and at the time we had grown too big to fit back where we were. We didn't know what to do. And so I kicked a stone. I called Dale Kibbe. I said, Dale, he goes, yes. I said, is that building still available? Yeah, why? Because we think we need it. Okay, you can just come by and pick up the keys. We'll figure out the rest. You can have service in there Sunday if you want. I remember we came back here, people were like, oh, I don't know if we should come back there. Oh my gosh, I don't know. We came back here and I just had this feeling. God was going to take us right back where he had us and he was going to go near, near, near. And he did. He brought us right back here. Do you know, is it today or next week? Is next week is the anniversary of us being back here 2 years. Back here, 2 years. That's freaky. Folks, it's a little creepy. God brought us back here for 2 years to take us to where he wanted us to be. My wife and I used to walk around. When we were dating, we'd walk Mel, the dog, around. And we would walk around that building. It was right shortly after it had been vacated. We'd walk over there and we'd just go, you know, we really feel like God wants us to have this building. Don't know how. Don't know how. But God had given us a vision. He'd given Keith Francis a vision when we started the church that this he would come into town, he would drive through town, and these huge buildings would have B Ministries logos on them all over the community. And they do, and they will. Well, Mike, pat me on the back. No. This isn't because we did anything right. We didn't do anything right. I'm going to say this. This is very pointed. It's very on purpose. We have had dozens, if not hundreds of people come in through this building that had all the right answers, that knew how things should be done, that were professionals, and they tried to apply that to obeying God. And it has done nothing but hurt the work of the kingdom of God. I will take anybody who is willing to lay down their agenda and their ideas and what they think is right and wrong and accept the will of God and seek after his agenda all day long. I don't care if you're only 3 feet tall and 500 pounds. You're on the team. You could be the most beautiful person on the face of the earth, the most successful person on the face of the earth, the most intelligent person. And if you don't want to come in and just simply seek after God and his plan and his kingdom and his work for the body of Christ, I don't want you on the team. I don't even want you in the building unless you want to submit and repent. Not submit to me. Submit to the Lord. Our intelligence, our natural abilities, our experience can be an awesome tool in the hands of God. And it can be the worst thing in the world for us to follow God because we rely on us and what we know instead of what God is calling us to. Let me tell you something. Mr. Wilson shared this in a Bible study on Tuesday night. Yeah, I know he was teaching a Bible study. He said, if you can't submit to the authority that God has placed over you today on earth, you will never be able to submit to God. Because God asks you to do way stupider things than this a man will ever ask you to do. God will ask you to do some of the most ridiculous things that make absolutely no sense whatsoever, that line up absolutely no way, no how, to any knowledge or experience you have. If you can't submit to an authority that God's placed over you today in the form of a man who is trying, or a woman, or whoever, who is trying to do the right thing, and they make a mistake, or they don't do it the way you think it should be done, you will never, ever, ever, ever be able to experience God. Ever! Because when God asks you to do things, it really looks stupid. I mean, it really looks stupid. Guys, you didn't have the visions. Maybe some of you had some, but when we started this ministry, I spent 2 to 3 years with God just giving me visions about this ministry and this church. And I would waffle back and forth as to whether to start the ministry or not. Finally, Jim Taylor came over to my house and said, "Are you going to do this or aren't you?" I said, "Yes." And I went to, guess who? Called Dale Kibbe up on the phone. He had a little storefront over here. And I said, "Guy, Space Terrain, I want to start a ministry." And Dale, who had planted a church, some of you guys might know the church, one of the churches he helped plant here in Marion was the Christian Center. He was excited to meet with me. We walked through the building. We talked about God. He said, "Listen, I'll give you this building for rent. For the first 6 months, it'll just be $100 a month. You can spend all the money you got, all the resources you got, trying to build your ministry. The next 3 months, it'll be $200 a month. The next, it'll be $300, and then it'll come up to $600. By the time it was $600, we were fine. God made a way. I had no clue what God was going to do. All I knew is the vision he gave me, and I needed to just simply step out and do what he told me to do. My Bible study today is about God's size vision. You've heard this before. I'm just going to sort of flow through it because you got my sermon. God's size task and victories. How many guys ever went into that building over there, the Y, and went, "Holy cow, are you sure we could do this?" And you say to God, "God, which piece of the elephant would you like me to chew on right now?" And then you start chewing on it. You want to hear what the fire marshal said? He said, "I am pleasantly surprised. You guys have done an incredible job. This building is in really good shape." He goes, "Honestly, I didn't want to come in here. I had no clue. I just had nightmares about what you were going to show me." Life is not about us, and it's not about ours, and it's not about our vision, and it's not about our success, and it's not about us accomplishing things for God. It is about God accomplishing his goal, and us submitting to him and lining ourselves up with what he is doing. Our life is not about us having the opportunity to experience our life dreams and hopes. It is about us obeying God and being with him in what he is doing. Romans 12:1-3, "Therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship." This is your true and proper worship. "Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will." Oh, so many of us take this passage out of context. "Do not conform to the pattern of this world." And we take it out of context. And although there's other passages to tell us to be separated from the world, that's not what this is talking about. This is talking about stop obeying God with your mind. Stop figuring out what God is doing. Stop deciding whether that makes sense to do or not. Just obey him. Do what he is doing. You are a living sacrifice. Whatever God is doing and he asks you to join him in doing, go do it. Stop wondering why. Stop wondering how. That's what this, do not conform to the pattern of this world that puts its trust and hope in man's understanding and man's intellect and man's knowledge base. That's not how God works. It just isn't. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. Philippians 3, 7 and 9, but what things were gained to me, those I counted lost for Christ. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but lost for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and do count them as dung that I might win Christ. Folks, so many of us get stuck on me preaching about giving up everything. No. If you give up everything and you still gaze back with a love and desire for those things, you haven't given them up. You have not accomplished the purpose of this scripture. This scripture says you give them up, and when you look back at them, they look like poop. And that's the Bible. It looks like a pile of poop. Now, how many piles of poop have you seen that you looked back upon and gazed upon with it fondly? Oh. I mean, there's been a couple of things that my daughters have left in the toilet that they wanted to take pictures of, but never seen such a big thing come out of such a little girl. But that's not what God's calling us to do. When we look back upon the things that we gave up to do what God called us to do, we're going to look at them as though they were silly, silly junk. It says, be found in him, not having mind of not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith. We obey him in faith, not in our understanding. I wish, if I was in charge of your spiritual development, if you were going to come to a school that I was running on being spiritual, the first thing I would do is I would ask you to do something that wasn't unbiblical, but that seems absolutely stupid. And I would look at you as an object lesson and say, if you can't do this, you will never be able to obey the Lord. Now, I've done that with teenagers before that I was in charge of ministering to. People said I was a jerk, I was arrogant, I was a cult leader. But those are the ones that are on the team fighting the fight today. Oh. I do it every once in a while at work. I'll look at somebody and say, no, you need to go do that. And they're like, why don't you have the new guy do that? Because I told you to do it. Any other questions? And they sort of get it out of the tone of my voice. If you don't go do it, you need to go put your applications in tomorrow. Because I don't want people who are laborers on my team getting a paycheck. I want people that are on the team. I mean, if I was doing that for money, I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing. What if I did that to you? What if you said to me, Pastor Mike, I want to be a part of this church? And the first thing I said was, okay, so what you need to do is you need to do this, this, and this, and this. And they were things that absolutely did not make sense. They weren't in your skill set. They weren't in your gift set, you know, the Holy Spirit gift thing. You can take a test, and they weren't in any of those sets, and you were like, well, that's just stupid. You know, I don't like to do that. Right, just do it anyways. What would you do? Chris says, at this point in my life, I'd just do it. Why? Because you've seen God move. That's why. Mm. John 12:23-25, Jesus replied, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Verily, truly, I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. Anyone who loves their life will lose it, while anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life." Something came to me, you know, so awesome. Sister Kay is such a blessing to this church. She offers such a balance to ministry. When she came here, all she knew was loving people. I've corrupted her over the years. Now she can be a stern, heavy hand. But all she knew was loving people. And at the time, I was a single pastor. I had started the church, and shortly after, my wife left me. I'm going to talk about count the cost. And Sister Kay came to this church because her daughter was showing up to this program on Saturday nights. And she came to figure me out. So being the wise woman that she is, she came with cookies. I mean, she knew I was a single guy. And she came with cookies. So no matter what she said, I was going to love her. And she makes some good cookies too. Anyways, just as I was saying what I said a few minutes ago, I was reading that scripture, this came to my mind. She came to a church in an old building in downtown on a storefront. Her daughter was coming here. She was getting involved in ministry. The pastor had just went through a divorce, and he was single. She came up here, and she was going to figure me out. She was going to blow my cover. She came, and she experienced God. Not because of things I said, but because she experienced God. And she had the faith to obey Him. She went to a churchy church. And she left that church and started attending here. It's been awesome, hasn't it? To see God move. It's scary. It's scary. I wasn't her kind of pastor. Not even close. We were oil and water. I'd get done preaching and she'd just be there at the back to love the people that got offended. It's okay. And I told her, I said, God sent you here because He knew I needed a balance and cookies. And shortly after she came, she went through a hardship and God performed a miracle in her life. And she experienced God. And she realized why God brought her here. I could tell you story after story after account after account after account of the supernatural moving of God. Paula over here, sitting here. My wife and I for years have taken young people in and ministered to them in times of need in their life or wherever they're at. And we were ministering to Paula's son, Eric, and Eric said, "My mom's in a bad place. We don't have any place to live." And God told my wife and I to just have her come and live with us for a few months till she could figure it out. My wife and I had been praying and thinking about a ministry like that for years, knowing that that was the vision that God had for the church. And so we would just do it ourselves. You know what I mean? You're like, well, the church can't do it, but we have the opportunity to do it. We're going to do it. It's awesome. Paula, you're here this morning. God just gave you a different job, and now you can be a part of the church. You're like, dude, I didn't say that, Pastor Mike. I said I could be at church on Sunday. Anyways, you know, she stayed with us for a few months, and we got to minister to their family, and then she got a job, and she moved on, and God's doing awesome things in her life. And now the church has a women's center. So when we obey God in our own personal lives, we open the door for Him to trust us with more. If we don't obey God in our personal lives, He can't. He can't. But if you fall to the ground and die with all of your hopes and dreams, you can produce many seeds. Anyone who loves their life will have to lose it, while anyone who hates their life in this world, they'll keep it for eternal life. Life is not about us. Our life is not about us having the opportunity to experience life and dreams. But most importantly, guys, God's plans and purposes in this earth are what life is about. He knew you in your mother's womb, and He has fashioned and purposed you for a plan and a purpose. And it's all good. God's plans, Jeremiah 1, 4 through 5, the call of Jeremiah, the word of the Lord came to me saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nation. And Daniel 5, 22, but you, Belshazzar, his son, have not humbled yourself, though you knew all this. Instead, you have set yourself up against the Lord of heaven. You had the goblets from his temple brought to you, and you and your nobles, your wives and your concubines, drank wine from them. You praised the gods of silver and gold, of bronze, iron, wood, and stone, which cannot see or hear or understand. Anybody have some things in your life you've been praising? You've been putting your affections on that are not God? Things that are made of silver and gold and wood and plastic? Crystal displays? You did not honor God, the God who holds in His hands your life and all your ways. Therefore, He sent the hand that wrote the inscription. This is the inscription that was written. Mine, tekel, parson. Here is what these words mean. God has numbered the days of your reign and brought it to an end. You have been weighed on the scales and found wanting. Your kingdom is divided and given into the Medes and the Persians. Then Belshazzar's command, Daniel was clothed in purple, a gold chain was placed around his neck, and he was proclaimed to the third highest ruler in the kingdom. That very night, Belshazzar, king of Babylonians, was slain. We don't understand and will never fully understand God. So first of all, our life is not about us. Second of all, God's plans and purposes on this earth are what our lives are supposed to be about. Third, we will never understand His plans. Isaiah 55, let the wicked forsake their ways and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them turn to the Lord and He will have mercy on them and to our God, for He will freely pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways and my thoughts than your thoughts. So the question is, am I okay with all of this? Am I okay with not understanding? Am I okay with never fully understanding God? Am I okay with never fully understanding exactly what He's doing and how He's doing it? Will I spend the rest of my Christian life trying to understand Him, or will I spend it being with Him? It's a huge question, folks. Will you spend the rest of your Christian life trying to be spiritual enough so that you can figure God out, or will you spend the rest of your Christian life just trying to be with Him, doing what He's doing? I have went to church all my life. I can't tell you the countless people that I've met that 30, 40, 50, 60, 70 years later are still trying to be spiritual enough to understand God. I don't need to understand God. I just want to be with Him. A desire to understand God is a desire to be equal to God or considered equal to God. And that is not our place. God-sized armies and seas, Moses in Egypt in the Red Sea. God-sized armies, Midian, Gideon and the Midianites. God-sized peoples, Joshua and Caleb. We talked about that last week. God-sized walls, Joshua and the cities and the armies of Canaan. A God-sized life. Is your life a God-sized life? Do you dream God-sized dreams? Do you have God-sized visions? Or do you just settle for whatever He gives you? The reason you settle for whatever He gives you is you would rather do that than submit your life to God. You'd rather be in control of the little world that He gives you than to be out of control submitting yourself to God. Folks, I can't tell you how many times I would wake up in the middle of the night and argue with myself for hours. How stupid I am. How foolish. How much of a waste of time this is. How you're just going to ruin your life. Ruin your children's lives. Ruin your family. You're just gonna, it's going to be a waste of time. Obeying God. You know the right thing to do, Mike. Just do it. But I also have a heart for the Lord. And God was saying, Mike, I need you to do this. Mike, I need you to do that. And here's the beautiful part about it. If you screw it up, it's okay. He'll give you a do-over. Oh, it'll hurt, but he'll at least give you a do-over. I've been down the do-overs a lot. How do I live? How do I live with God-sized dreams and God-sized goals and God-sized life? Or do I? 16 years ago, what were you dreaming about? Huh? How old were you 16 years ago, Debbie? No, how old were you 16 years ago? 12. We don't even want to know what she was dreaming about at 12. Dan, where were you 16 years ago? What were you dreaming about? Trying to put his life back together. I want to challenge you folks, if you've got a mess up in your life and you don't know what to do with it, who cares? Does that mean God doesn't have a plan for you till you fix your life? No, God's got a plan with you. He's just waiting for you. The mess up was probably him trying to finally get you to submit your life. I mean, when we understand that God allows everything to happen to you that happens to you, Satan doesn't sneak anything by God. If it happened to you, God knew it was going to happen. Maybe God's just trying to get you to surrender. As soon as you surrender, God will make a way. Always does. Give your life to God. Let Him determine your plans. Let Him determine your purpose. And let Him determine the victories. Some of you are like, Pastor Mike, you're not going to rest on your laurels. Oh, no. God, you haven't even, most of you have not received the whole vision that God has given me for this ministry. All I know is Him giving us that building takes us steps closer to fulfilling His vision. I'm so stoked. I can't hardly see straight. I can't hardly sleep. I wake up and I'm like, let's go. Why? Folks, how do I say this? You have a hard time coming to church? It's because it didn't cost you anything yet. Did you hear it? You have a hard time coming to church? It's because it hadn't cost you nothing yet. You're still on the tit sucking off of mama. You're showing up to church to get fed. It hadn't cost you nothing. Folks, you can't drag me out of church. Not because I love church. No. Because that's what God called me to do, and I have spent way too much time, energy, and life. All the bridges are burnt. This is all I got left. Let me tell you something. Don't you dare make God take everything from you till it's all you've got left. And if you do, you will deserve every last thing you get because you were warned. But he will. He will take everything. He will allow everything to be taken from you. And you know what? There's two ways you can look at this. You can either give it to him freely and count it all as dung, or he will take it from you and you will curse it. I'm telling you, the key to an unbelievable life is submit yourself to God. Live for him with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. You're a living sacrifice. Your life is not your own. You were bought with a price. You don't have a right to choose what you're going to do, where you're going to go, and how you're going to do it. You want the key? If you don't believe me, ask my beautiful wife. You want the key to understanding how to experience God and how to live a life of constant being used of God to minister to people and watch God move in people's lives and watch God. You want to know what the key is? It has nothing to do with anything except, what do you want me to do today, God? Just wake up. God, what are you doing? What am I supposed to do? I'm driving home last night after a long day working at the church, so excited. My truck just goes, I look down and the gauge light comes on, hot things all the way over to hot, and I'm like, uh-oh. I stop, get out, look, radiator's cool. I'm like, Get in, thermostat gone down a little bit. I'm like, well, maybe, we'll try. Get down the road a little bit more. It just goes, and stalls as I'm driving with about 3,000 pounds on my trailer behind me. It's my work truck. Get out, engine just blows, liquid coming out the back end of the engine. I'm like, So it doesn't stop there, folks. So I'm sitting there stranded. Chris comes down and says, well, take me down to the barn. I'll get the tractor, drive it down here. We'll pull the truck up into the barnyard and I'll figure it out, in a couple weeks, I guess. I don't know. And we go down there and get the tractor. Just as we pull out of the barn, it just starts pouring. I mean, that storm we had last night about 10 o'clock, I was driving a tractor, pulling my dead truck and trailer behind me. I had a T-shirt over my head because otherwise I wouldn't be able to see nothing. Just pouring. Apparently there was a tornado siding down in Delaware. I'm just out there pulling my tractor. I get into the house. I'm like, Beth, what do you think God's trying to do? She goes, I don't know, but I think he wants you to get a new truck. I said, I don't want to buy a new truck. I don't want to spend the money. I want to do that. I was like, well, I could fix the motor, but the truck was undersized for what I do with it now. It's like, put $2,000 or $3,000 in that truck to have a truck that I'm going to burn the engine up again because it's too small. Everything that happens to you, you say, God, why? What do you want me to do? God, what do you want to do? What do you want me to do? That's the key to experiencing God. It's not, oh, I wonder what God wants me to do. No. God, what do you want me to do? Don't you dare sit around and collaborate with your friends about what God's doing. God, unless you know their friends that understand this principle, don't you dare sit around and try to figure out what God's doing. You will cause so much dissension in the body of Christ. It's amazing. Well, Pastor Mark, I think it should be done this way. Good for you. I didn't think it should be done this way. This is just the only way that God gave us an opportunity to do it. And it don't matter how we get it done. It doesn't matter if it's done right or wrong. What matters is, were we able to get it accomplished? Yes. We're so excited about our sidewalks. I can't wait to go over there and pull the tarps off our sidewalks. And they are not pretty. And I don't care. Can people walk down them and not trip? Yes! Then the glory of God has been accomplished. Are they right? No! Are they done well? Who knows? It rained on them last night. But no one's going to trip and fall. We had people, we're out there trying to do the sidewalks. You couldn't ride your bike down that sidewalk. It would knock you off. You know those sidewalks you ride your bike on it and the front tire will stick and flip you off the front? That's the kind of sidewalk that is. I don't care. We're going to get out there. I'm going to pull those off. I'm going to sweep the sidewalk and go, wow, it's beautiful. Why? Because that's the way God gave us the ability to fix them. And I can't tell you how many people in this community have been ministered to by the fact that we're out there fixing our sidewalks. You know what? I gotta tell you this. I know somebody who talked to the person who sold us the building, who owns a masonry company. And I can promise you that man is elated that we were out there fixing our own sidewalks. Even if we had the money to pay his company to come and do it. Yesterday I said, who was I talking to yesterday? And they said, well, I was talking to the guy you bought the building from. And all they told me was, the building is going to be used for what God had it built for to begin with. Who was it? Somebody? It was just yesterday. I snorted too much concrete dust yesterday. Now I can't think about nothing. The point of my sermon today, folks, is, are you living a God-sized life? Is God greater than your life? You know how we know if God's greater than your life? When bad things happen in your life, you go, God, what are you doing? Not, what are you doing? Is God greater than your family? See, a lot of you guys are like, Pastor Mike talks about family and blah, blah. No. See, some of you are willing to sit and listen to me say it because you were here when God took mine. I was doing what God wanted me to do. She was right there with me. Come home one day and she's like, I'm out of here. I can't do this. I can't. I got hopes and dreams and all you want to do is minister to people in downtown Marion. You're a better person than me. Counseled with 7 pastors. All but one of them said, you need to quit the ministry and go try to fix your marriage with your wife. And I was like, is God bigger than your family? You have to obey the Lord. You have to. I left the door open, man. I came this close to getting a restraining order. I sending her flowers on her birthday. We're still married. She hadn't served me with papers yet. I sent her flowers for her birthday. She says, don't talk to me. Don't send me nothing. You leave me alone. In the note she wrote me, the dear Mike note, it was, please don't try to contact me because I love you. She was saying, if I talk to you, you'll convince me to come back and do what God told us to do. I'm not joking, folks. My wife, Beth, read the letter. I kept it. There ain't no woman going to believe that happened. I'd send her flowers. She finally, 2 days after I sent her flowers, she had me served with papers. I was like, well, I am free to run. But it was, I did everything I could do to save my marriage. I did everything I could do. But I couldn't stop doing what God told me to do. And I was stupid enough to believe that if I continued to obey God, He would give me the family He wanted me to have. And He has. Some of you are sitting here and you've been arguing with your spouse about obeying God. And you weren't the one arguing that you should obey God. Let that serve to you as a warning. And it's a warning. I've watched it happen, folks. Let that serve to you as a warning. God will give you over to your absolute selfish madness, and it will destroy you, and He will set your spouse free of you. I've watched it happen in more than my life. You need to obey God. You need to do what He's telling you to do. Don't disrespect your husband. If you can't obey your husband, you can't obey God. Just to let you know. But you need to obey the Lord. Your husband tells you to do something that's immoral, you look at him and say, no. I love you, but that ain't happening. If he doesn't listen, call me. I'll come over and talk to him. If I need to, I'll bring some people with me. Is God bigger than your life, your hopes, and your dreams? Is He bigger than your family? And is He bigger than you? See, some of you are willing to give up your family and give up your life, but you're not willing to give up what you think about yourself. You're not willing to give up control. You're not willing to give up being right. You got snorting people up here. What's going on here? Yeah. We're not willing to devalue ourselves and obey God. We're not willing to do it. And so we're going to be robbed of God-sized victories. I'm going to say it. I'm going to use these words, not because I think I'm equal to Christ, but because it's a great argument. You ready? If you don't want to believe me, because I was quoting Scripture and I shared with you the truths of the Word of God, then will you even believe me because of the works God has done? I just wish you could have seen this ministry from the inside out for the last 16 years. Completely out of control. No real direction, just trying to obey God. Jim Taylor is the treasurer. We'd look at each other and go, well, you think God still wants us to do this? Yep. There's money in the bank. We can pay the bills. I guess we better show up again. I'm not exaggerating. Because we were thinking, well, maybe we did something and inspired some people. Maybe we're supposed to close the doors and it would be like, nope, God still paid the bills. I guess we better keep going. Today, I remember driving past Apex, the Marian Catholic High School. I remember getting mad because Marian Catholic would not respond to my phone call. Catholic Church would not respond to my phone call. Because we were, at that time, we were coming out of the mall, and we needed a place to go. And I remember being frustrated with God that He would give them a building like that, and yet we didn't have any place to go. And I remember God saying, just shut up. And over the couple weeks, I found out that they're in a lease, and the Catholic diocese is planning on selling that property. And so they're just leasing it to them for a year or two, which is a bad idea when you're planting churches, just trust me. Growing into something you can't replace. I remember, and then God one day just says, here's the money, go buy the Y. Folks, when we bought that Y, it was the dumbest decision I could have ever made. No, I'm serious. The amount of work that needs to be done in that building, we did not, and still do not have the resources to do all that work. We did not have the resources to get it to pass inspections, to get it to be able to be used. All we had was our abilities, natural abilities, and a little bit of money after we paid for the building. That money could have been put in a bank account. We could have looked around. We have a facility over here on Prospect Street. We could have remodeled that and made it a Taj Mahal for the amount of money that we had in the bank. But that's not where God told us to go and what He told us to do. We decided to buy that building. I know the council said it was okay. In the back of my mind, as far as a businessman goes and somebody makes decisions, that was just stupid. But that's what God told us to do. Do you realize up until Thursday of this week, all the money, all the energy, everything we did in that building could have been completely a waste of time, and we could have been stuck with a building that we weren't allowed to use? Do you realize that? For any reason, any little reason, it could have been that way. Anything. Anything. I couldn't sleep for days and days and days. Dan and Phil and I walked through that building with that man, and at any moment we were waiting for him to say, oh, you guys can't do this. This is a disaster. Instead, we sat up there for the next half hour after we got done with the walkthrough, and we went through the plans, and he was geeking out about the plans, and we were looking through the building, and he offered to do things for us, and he gave us tips on how to get around things. He said, could you guys just go ahead and put a couple more emergency lights in and try to wire an outlet over here for that there? And he goes, you guys do really good work, man. I just love these kind of calls when I get to go into a building with people like you guys. I said, is there any way you could come back later this week and give us the final? He goes, oh, I'm off on Friday. I'll try to work in on Thursday. He worked as if he came in. There was like 16 things. He walked through the building. Yep, that's good. The one room we went into, he was on the phone talking to somebody. He said he was in a hurry, and then we were done with the inspection, and we stood there and talked some more. He wanted us to make sure we could use the building. He shared with us that he was on the phone with the state inspector. He was on the phone with our architect. He was on the phone with people in the community about us using that building. He did our work for us. God threaded the needle. Here you go, Mike. I'll do what I told you to do. It's a matter of faith. Folks, you can't have faith and do this. You can't. You just can't. Ask God to grow your faith. Ask Him. You want some God-sized victories? If you don't believe me because I read the Word to you, believe me for what God has done as you've been watching. Our last council meeting was last week. We sat around a table and said, well, we might be able to use the building, we might not. Folks, we spent $200-some thousand dollars on, well, that's what God told us to do. I'd look at my wife. You know, honey, this doesn't work. These people are going to hate me. These people are going to hate me. Think I'm the stupidest person on the face of the earth. That guy left Tuesday, and Dan and I just went, he was telling us the things we could do to make it even more official. God-sized victories. I was going to preach another sermon, and I'll end it with this. To whom much is given, much is required. So I say that with this. We are going to be making a schedule. I'm going to make the schedule that God wants me to make. You are going to commit to being there, not once or twice, but on a consistent basis, to make sure we are able to use that building the way God wants us to use it. There'll be times you can schedule yourself in. There will be qualifications for those times, what's expected of you. Okay? And then you guys can just volunteer to obey the Lord. Okay? When we're talking about after school programs, building open, we're talking about having open gyms for children after school, building being open in the weekends, building being open for the thrift store and other ministries that we've been asked to assume. Do you know there's a church in the community that wants us to assume their food pantry ministry? They just want us to assume it. In other words, just come in, learn from them, and take over. A bunch of 60, pushing 70-year-old women and don't know how to do it. The church has the money to do it. They don't know how they're going to keep doing it. Nobody in their church is they're the youngest people in their church. And they're just like, oh, we would love for you to do this. Best part is they're our neighbors. Right there. We can't even grasp what God's plans are. Do you understand this? Can't even grasp. We, right after the fire marshal walked through and gave us an approval, we went over to the Historical Society and sat down with Gail over there, and she's just elated that we're her neighbor and we're going to work together in the community to do things. We're going to develop a little garden area there between the buildings, and we're going to share our parking lots and do all kinds of things. And they asked us, the youth ministry, to sell their parking spaces during the popcorn festival just so that we could have the money to do ministry. We have no clue. I do have a pretty good idea what he's planning because he gave us a really big building. God-sized victories, folks. For those of you that are questioning things, don't. I have no answers for you. I just know this. We're doing what God wants us to do. Okay? I don't know what the plan is. If I knew what the plan was, you'd have to pay me. Think about that. She's laughing. Think about it. What are we going to do with the Prospect Street building? Do you know that it could be that the only reason God gave us that building and he gave us the money to take that building was to force us to get our 501c3? Do you know that? For those of you who don't know, the church is going through the process of getting their 501c3 with the government, because otherwise the person that donated the money for us to buy that building would be hit with an enormous tax burden. Okay? And so we're going through the process to get that taken care of. And as we've done that, we've realized there are people waiting to give us money to do ministry. But they can't. Why? Because they can't. Because we're not a 501c3 organization. It's reporting to the government so that we can be considered a real church and be tax exempt. See, when people give money to a church like this, if they're not 501c3, they have to prove to the IRS that this is a church, or they have to pay taxes on that gift. Okay? Folks, this could just be the beginning. We could look back at this moment and say, man, I'm glad God forced our hand. We have senators and representatives that are willing to, that are interested in giving us money to do ministry that, like we want to do them. We have community organizations in this community that are willing to give us money to do ministry like we want to do it. Okay? And I know for a fact there are hundreds and thousands of people in this community that are at the end of their life and not knowing what to do with their money. The only reason we don't have the money to do the things that God wants us to do is because we haven't asked. Because we haven't asked. We haven't accepted God-sized dreams and God-sized victories. We've been trying to figure out how we were going to do it. And just, instead of just obeying. Think about it. You're like, yeah, man, those people give their money, then we won't have to pay tithes and offerings. You don't understand what we're talking about. You don't understand. You've lost. You're done. You don't get it. Okay? You don't understand. This isn't about money. This is about faith. That's what this is about. Today, the police officers, the emergency medical people, the hospitals, the counseling centers, the probation officers, and the judges send people to be ministries. The people that no one else wants to do anything with. Imagine if all they had to do is say, go to 193 East Church Street, and there'll be a desk there, and talk to whoever's there. They have a homeless shelters, discipleship centers, food pantry, clothing locker, ministries, counseling ministries, recovery ministries. Just go there. All of those things are happening already in our church. They've just been started. There's little sprouts. God has given us the facilities to do the rest. Stay focused. Don't be distracted by positive things or negative things. Okay? Stay focused. You know why I want you to stay focused? I don't say this, it sounds, but I'm serious. Because I want to labor with you. 16 years from now, I want you to be here when we have the same discussion. Like Angie and Evan and Kay and Dan and Debbie and Jordan. Jordan's been around for, Jordan goes back. Tom, I want you to be here. Phil, I want you to be here. I don't want you to remember. I want to be there with you in the victory. I want you to experience God. I want you to experience God like I've experienced God. I don't know how we're going to get that building, but I think God wants us to have that building. Then God says, here, go get it. Listen, this is how it works. Here, go get it. Okay. You get it, you buy it, and then your mind starts going, well, this will never work. Right? Well, you're not doing this right. You don't have enough for this. And shut up! I'm obeying God. And I'm doing what God wanted me to do. Trust me, dude. Phil remembers, nobody wants to go to a church that the pastor just got divorced from, right? Pastor's wife just left him. Who in the world would want to go to a church like that? Then Sulu asked me to do his wedding. Yes. Yeah. And I was just like, why would you want me to do your counseling and your wedding? I suck at this, obviously. Because they were willing to obey the Lord. Folks, please, 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 please. Put your trust in the Lord. We're going to experience the victories. We'd like for you to go with us. Okay? And that's not a joke. It's not the first time I've said it. Okay? We'd like for you to be there with us. It would be a blast. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for your grace and mercy and that you love us even though we are so fickle, we are so selfish. Help us get outside of ourselves and what we think and all the things that we think are going on. Just focus on what you told us to do and be with you and go where you're going and do what you're doing. Help us to do this. I want to see your victories, God. I want to see more and more and more. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven and in my life. Because I want to be with you. In your holy name we pray, Jesus. Amen. Thanks for being here today, folks. Have a great day.
Let's get this.